everyone. I'm your host, Brian Solis. Welcome to another episode of Revolution. I am excited and extremely pleased to have with us a very special guest who's also someone I get to call a good friend, Charlene Li, who is the author of the best-selling new book, Open Leadership. She was also the co-author of another bestseller, Groundswell. And today we're going to talk a little bit about what it takes to be an open leader in this era of social media and social technology. I have this saying that I often share with executives: if a conversation takes place online and you're not there to hear it, did it really happen? And as we look at words that are becoming pervasive in a social era, such as transparency and authenticity and openness, we have to look at the greater meaning of not just these words or these buzzwords, but actually what it really takes to become an open leader. So the name of the show is Revolution, with an emphasis on both revolution and evolution. And with that, I would like to welcome officially Charlene to the show. Thank you very much for being on.
Thank you for having me.
The transformation of leadership is no small undertaking. And I wonder, in your experience, if you see it being more of a revolution or an evolution in order to at least get the process moving in the right direction?
Well, I think, first of all, it by nature, leadership doesn't go in fits and starts. It's something you evolve and move into. So I do fundamentally believe it's an evolution of how you get to that point, especially being a leader in the social media space. It is so different. It requires that leaders think in a completely different way, one where they're going to open up and share information, decision-making, where everything, every single fiber in their body says, control it, command it.
Right.
That's what it means to be a leader, to be in charge. And yet in this new era, I think it is much more about what you can enable and bring in and bring people together by giving up that control. And in that process, you actually get more power. So, but the revolution part is very interesting. I think most leaders won't get to that point. They will not move into that area because it is so difficult for them to do that. So therefore, it takes a revolution. It takes this breaking point where they realize they cannot survive anymore even. They have to be forced and pushed into that new space, dragged, kicking and screaming oftentimes, as you have probably seen. And usually, unfortunately, it comes to these cataclysmic external forces, really bad situations that make them sit up and realize, I gotta do things differently.
I like to call this the aha versus the uh-oh moment, where very few leaders look at the aha with the opportunity that's present before them, where they react to the uh-oh moment, where we see something like the BP oil spill account on Twitter, where suddenly BP had to start to consider a social presence, or with the unfortunate videos that hit YouTube for Domino's, where suddenly Domino's needed to now have a social strategy. But we're looking at decades of closed, top-down leadership where even engagement was outsourced to outside agencies or to overseas agencies. What is it that you're seeing that, in terms of the individual within the organization, is it really the leader who says we need to embrace social, or is it a champion or a catalyst internally that says, let's think about this differently and here's why?
It's all of those. I mean, I've talked to a lot of these social media strategists, the realists, optimists is what I call them, somewhere in the middle of the organizations or sometimes in the front lines. And they're the ones who oftentimes are that catalyst, the person who lives in that space. But I've met quite a few CEOs also who get that aha moment, and they lead. They lead absolutely strongly from the top of the organization. Howard Schultz at Starbucks, Chris Conde at SunGard, financial services, retail, at the top of the game. And what's interesting is they're leading at the very top. They got front lines people who are just right behind them. And then you come into this thing called middle management, and they're incredibly threatened because they hang on to the hierarchy that closeness actually creates, information showing up and down stovepipes, authority inside decision making. And so when the CEO is connecting with the front lines through these informal channels, guess what happens? Chaos.
Right.
All this angst comes up. And I think we're going into that period now where it's not so much about enterprise 2.0 as it is about leadership 2.0. What does it mean to be a leader
right
when you don't have control anymore?
Well, you know, That's a fantastic question, because we look at what is going to put the leader in open leadership, and we see over the years different types of, I don't want to say leaders because that could be questioned, but we'll just say different types of CXOs, and those could be either risk-taking or risk-averse. And I would imagine that with social, there has to be a common trait in terms of one willing to take risks. But I also see a pushback in the sense of, well, how big is social really? And when we look at the idea of that, if a conversation takes place online idea, how big does it have to be for them to pay attention or to commit resources, to commit teams, to commit budget for them to actually go down this path?
I don't think it has to be that big. In fact, it's huge. Because if you take away the social technology part of it, mm-hmm. take away all the things around Twitter and Facebook, and you sit down with the executive and say, how important are relationships to your business? And they will say, absolutely central. It is the most important thing. Business is all about relationships.
Right.
And then you go, what relationships can you define them? What kind of relationships do you want with your employees and with your customers? And they can describe that sometimes in great detail. And then you show them, this is how social can enable that. And it's in the context of regular, everyday doing business that you have to explain social technologies. Because if you try to bring leaders who have no idea what this new world looks like, kicking and dragging and screaming into it, they won't understand it. But if you can go into their world and live and understand what their most important goals are, and most leaders are only focused on maybe 3 or 5 goals, period.
When you're dealing with the executive management level, the question that they have is whether or not these are the playgrounds of, you know, the younger generations, right? Because many of them aren't necessarily on Facebook or Twitter as individuals. And so what ends up happening a lot of times is that they put certain people on the front lines just because they understand how to use these social technologies, not because they feel it's the right thing to do, and definitely not with a directive or a strategy that's going to help business outcomes. But I wonder, at some point, we have to figure out a way to change not just the operation of this, and definitely not just the leadership, but also start to take a crack at shaping or shifting the culture of the organization to be more open. And it definitely takes a leader, but at the same time, do you see that there's a chance for outside influences within the organization, for example, to help change or transform or expedite the need for change of the culture within?
So I think, again, externally, the group that's going to cause the greatest amount of change are the customers. Mm-hmm. The customers being out there, if you're listening to them at all, they're saying, hey, knock, 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 I'm here on Twitter, you can listen to me. I'm here on Facebook. B2B companies say, oh, I don't need to be on Facebook. Well, we just do a quick search for their product or name and services, and lo and behold, they're on Facebook. So where are you? Do you want to be part of that conversation that people are having or not? I mean, you can choose still, but they're there. So I go back to, what are the places organizationally where you have to look at, what are the external forces? It is, again, the most important one, the one that pays the bills. It's your customers.
Right.
That do this.
And do you believe that there are others, maybe the champion within, who's also maybe someone who has the ear of the CEO? Is this book for them as well?
Well, I think the book is for multiple people. There are, first of all, the CEOs, the obvious executives and mm-hmm. leaders inside the organization. But it's also for those people who are trying to influence them, and they mm-hmm. themselves are trying to figure out, how do I be a more effective leader?
Right.
I talk about 4 different archetypes of leaders, and one of them is the realist optimist, the person who's really the change agent. But I also have one of my favorite people, the worried skeptic. You know, this person is just worried to death about what's going to go wrong. How do you get that person to feel comfortable? And actually be a leader in their own right, because they actually are very right in being worried about things. Mm-hmm. How do you leverage that, and how do you work with the other archetypes to support that person
right.
to feel comfortable with this?
And one of the things that I've seen as well is this idea of experimentation or pilot programs, not just from leaderships, but also with social technology. And one might experiment outside of just the need to realize there's an opportunity to change the leadership, but mostly because this is a have to, because competitors are on Facebook and Twitter, or they're reading about it in Ad Age or Wall Street Journal or the New York Times. And so in those cases where it begins, let's just say from the bottom up, and definitely not a top down strategy, what's the switch when executive role realizes that there's a bigger opportunity here to socialize the business?
Yeah, I think all of these organic kind of initiatives, a little Twitter here, a little bit of YouTube there, and people just sort of doing it because they can get away with it, I guess, is the way I think about it. usually at some point there's a conflict internally, or they're trying to go after the same customer, they're fighting over the YouTube channel, for example. When somebody in corporation goes, stop it, this is irrational. We have 16 different brands on Facebook and no one knows which is the real us.
Right.
Or the CEO goes, all right, which of these things are us, or what does it look like? Who are we as a brand, and what kind of relationship do you want? And usually it grows up, and then at some point, everyone blows it up and reforms it again to something more rational. That's exactly what happened with HP. I mean, they had all these great initiatives, very good homegrown initiatives, but it wasn't coordinated. So they did this thing called Operation Clean Sheet. Basically started from scratch and saying, what is it that we want?
Right.
And did at the corporate level, put enough structure in there. Again, interesting thing, they put structure around being open. And so, but enough structure so that everyone had the freedom to go do what they needed and wanted to. But now it's consistent. Instead of having 58 different Facebook pages, they have something like 9.
Right.
It's rational. It's aligned with their strategic goals as business units in different areas. And they have all the same branding and clean look around things. And they have tremendous freedom within those templates to make it work. They created all these sandboxes. And everyone is in agreement about it.
I believe that's actually a lot of what the future of social business looks like. And I hope that this is what we see sooner than later, because there has to be structure to this. In fact, at some point, we're going to have to embrace the groundswell and then place a top-down strategy and leadership program, so that way this is not just driving the team, as well as the innovation behind what the team's capable of, but also by maybe not controlling, but definitely leading the marketplace. And I think that's what individuals are looking for. They're looking to be heard, they're looking for resolution, they're looking to be part of the process, but they're also looking to have something to believe in. And if organizations aren't embracing this opportunity to demonstrate leadership, I believe that someone else will. And so with that, I would love, Charlene, for you to give us a few parting words or bits of advice for those watching.
Yeah, I think most importantly than anything else is to redefine what leadership means. It is no longer about controlling resources or controlling people. It's about inspiring people. And if you think about the best leaders, the people you would follow to the ends of the earth, they didn't command and control you. They inspired you towards a common goal. And the tools that leaders have to use today are tremendous. You don't have to just be able to sit next to somebody and inspire them. You can inspire them with your words, with your image, and be able to use these tools is something I think that leaders have to get very good at. Be really good and confident and excel at this art of sharing.
And that's open leadership, and that's what it's going to take to win. Not just in business, but just in general. And this is what it's going to take to earn the relationships of your customers, your prospects, and the individuals who connect them. Open leadership to me is exactly what Charlene said. It's about inspiring people. And if you can't inspire people, then how can you possibly expect that they can follow you to wherever it is that you're going? How can you possibly expect that they will support you in your endeavors? Leadership, inspiration, empathy, these are all emotional ties, and that's what we find that really powers and connects social media, is the idea of emotion, the idea of self-expression, the idea of being part of a very personal community or network where individuals are connected around themes and interests and passions, and you have to earn your way into that. So this is your moment to define who you want to be today and tomorrow.